I was serving in Vietnam at the time, the Marine and Naval Attaché at our embassy in Hanoi. And I'd been there about a year, and I'd been exposed to a lot of things, I'd seen a lot of things, but there was one particular occasion where I had the opportunity to see some dogs that were on their way to essentially become someone's meal at a restaurant. And I'd had a moment of, I guess, a connection with one of the dogs. You know, when your eyes meet somebody else's eyes, and it doesn't matter if it's a human or an animal, but you get that connection. Well, I had that connection, and I could feel, almost sense the desperation. You know, I mean, really empathy when you know what that other creature is feeling. And there was some desperation and some terror there. And I wanted to do something to stop it, but quite frankly, I just didn't have the courage at the time, the fortitude to step up and make a quick decision. And the more I pondered it and wrestled with it, I lost time, and eventually I couldn't make that decision because the motorcycle on which these dogs were traveling was gone. And later that day, in a restaurant, I happened to see a dog being prepared for butchering to be cooked up for the evening meal. And at that moment, I had this transformative experience where suddenly it just went very clear for me. Night turned to day, and I decided at that moment that I was never going to eat another animal again.
There was a calf at Farm Sanctuary in Watkins Glen, New York, named Lee. Lee was a horrible abuse case. Came to Farm Sanctuary just a few days old and couldn't even stand up. And I was one of the volunteers that tried to get Lee to walk, and the thinking was if Lee could walk, he would live. And Lee actually did stand up and tried to take a few steps, but unfortunately Lee did not make it. He died at a couple of weeks old. And Lee, showed me the connection between the meat and the dairy industries, because Lee would have been a veal calf. So it's easy to boycott veal, but Lee was actually a connection that showed me that it's not just veal, it's also milk. And it was Lee's inspiration that led me to go vegan.
I went vegan, there's two answers. One is my brother went vegetarian, and that told me that it was even possible. And so then I went vegetarian, then I went vegan. The other answer is the motivational side of it, and the reason I did it was because I wanted to help animals. I'd always been an animal lover, I'd also always been an environmentalist. And once I started really taking notice of the horrible environmental effects and the horrible treatment of animals on these factory farms and even on family farms, so-called, I just couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't participate in anymore, and I started reducing, and I went vegetarian, and then I went vegan after forcing myself to watch just, the horrific videos that are available on the internet, because I knew it would do it. I actually forced myself to do that knowing that there was no turning back after that point.
And I spent my summers on my uncle's farm, probably the last, say, 4 or 5 years of my high school years and junior high. My uncle had a farm up in Canada, and there was cows, chickens, and pigs. And his father was a veterinarian, but he became a butcher. And so the animals that we were growing were actually for slaughter. I mean, I used to pick up pigs when they were little baby pigs, and we'd take a scalpel and make two slits in their scrotum and pop their balls out, snip them off, throw some powder on it, and let them squeal around. Oh, it didn't hurt them. They don't have much sensitivity there. And it was really disturbing for me, but I was around all these men, and I had no other frame of reference other than that, if it's the only frame of reference you're given, that's it for you.
You would think that everyone right now knows how animals are treated on factory farms, right? Because it's been in the news so much. But we still come across people every day that read our booklets and say they had no idea this was going on, which is shocking. But there's still a lot of people out there. So, a lot of people really, people don't seek out this sort of media. They don't go to the internet and say, hey, I wonder if I could learn about factory farms today, or if a TV show comes on that might start talking about that, they flip the channel. There's, people TiVo what they watch these days. So people have a lot of control over what they see, and they don't have to see things they don't want.
I decided at a very young age that I wanted to join the military because I felt called to protect people who couldn't protect themselves. I wanted to defend the defenseless and speak up for the voiceless, not just here, but around the world. And when I put it all together and realized that, in fact, this whole time, I had been oppressing animals and exploiting animals, you know, creatures that had every bit as much a sense of fear and joy and happiness and terror that I could feel or that my dog or my cat could feel, then honestly, I had to align my principles with my actions, and there was no other choice for me.
We have to speak up on behalf of these animals that can't mobilize on their own behalf. You know, certainly they kick and scream and struggle in slaughterhouses. They protest to the best of their ability, but they need us to stand up, to lobby Congress, to protest, to speak to others. And that really is the challenge. That is the obligation, I think, that we have.
I mean, you see a different insight in that you see it as a dead body. You don't see it as a steak, a mouth-watering steak anymore, you know? Because in my opinion, you wake up to the reality because subconsciously you have to justify yourself when you're eating meat that it's okay. You know, if you see, for example, you see a truck rolling by you full of pigs that you know are gonna get murdered, you kind of just subconsciously block that out so that you can focus on, you know, the next turn you're gonna make. You know, in the same way, you know, that's what we have to do in order to stay balanced. You know, we have to block out the fact that this is a dead animal, be it all our subconscious, if you will, in order to keep ingesting that, because otherwise we'll feel guilty.
I lost over 100 pounds. My eyesight corrected itself within just a few months. My diabetes went away in 8 months. You can't even tell that I used to be diabetic anymore. And it was cool. I started getting more energy. Like, I was an athlete in high school. I played basketball. I was always active, and then all of a sudden I was able to do stuff like go and hike the Grand Canyon, and I only trained 4 weekends to do it. I went from nothing to being able to hike the Grand Canyon rim to rim.
I found that it has a massive impact not only on my energy level, but on my, I have to think on my feet in my job, and so, you know, I can kind of bowl through the job itself when I'm low energy, but what I can't do is think on my feet. And so now this new clarity that's coming around is as I up the intake of fresher and fresher foods, I'm finding it even easier. It's the opposite of deprivation. It actually is making it much easier to live my life and do my job.
So vegans on average have much lower cholesterol levels than non-vegetarians. The average is about 160 for vegans, whereas it's about 200 for non-vegetarians. 200 is just on the borderline of what's considered unhealthy for people, so vegans are well below that. Vegans tend to have lower rates of high blood pressure. 30% to 50% as much diabetes.
I am 43 years old. I've been in the Marine Corps for 22 years. I'm probably in the best physical condition of, you know, I wouldn't say of my life, certainly. I'm not a 20-year-old anymore, but I'm fit. I'm probably more fit. I'm probably more of a combat-ready round than any other Marine my age. Probably, you know, quite a bit younger than my age. So I think it's just ludicrous to say that the vegans are, you know, pasty white frail guys. That's not the case.
Right, so the big myth is that plants don't have any protein. And hopefully most people know by now that plants do have protein, but the way things are broken down in grade school is that meat is synonymous with protein and there aren't any other sources. Well, that's completely untrue. Plants have protein in them.
Well, you know, protein is not about it's not about, you know, animal products. Protein is simply amino acids. What a protein is a chain of amino acids, and the chain of amino acids that you ingest is broken. Each link to that chain is broken when you put that food in your body. Now, when those links are broken, then the amino acids are separated, and that's what your body uses to build your muscles. So what you need is a complete amino acid profile. That's the key to building muscle. Dandelion greens have a complete amino acid profile. Look at a gorilla. A gorilla has the strength equivalent, and this is from Stephen Arlen's book that really inspired me, to bench pressing 4,000 pounds. Where does he get his protein? Leaves and fruit.
You know, women have traditionally been more open to vegetarianism than men have. I think that there are certainly a lot more men these days than there used to be, and that's good. And there's a lot of really good male role models that are vegans these days. A lot of bodybuilders are vegan, and they've made themselves, you know, they've made an effort to do outreach to communities like Jim Morris, who spoke here yesterday, and Robert Cheek, who is goes around giving talks all the time about vegan bodybuilding. There's a number of other people, a number of ultimate fighters are vegan. So we're starting to break down that stereotype.
And I always think to myself, you know, where are the guys? Why aren't the guys stepping up? I mean, do they realize what's at stake here? I mean, it's their kids, you know, it's their children and their children's children. It's our very society. It's the stability of our economy. It's the whole package tied together. And if we're gonna be the kind of dads, you know, that we wanna be, if we wanna be heroes to our sons and daughters, then we have to step up and we have to do something to defend their heritage, what we're gonna pass down to them. We have to be there right now to make sure that it's still there for them when their turn comes.
Not scary, we're not monsters or freaks. We're not pasty, pale, skinny, shaking chihuahuas. You know, we actually are living vibrant lives on a plant-based diet.
If everybody, say, let's just say in this country, if everybody in America knew and understood that the healthiest way and the more peaceful way to choose their food, they would do it in this fashion. And I think that that's what really what would create a healthier environment entirely.
There's effects on our water, our environment, our soil. There's effects on the public health and personal health. And there's a whole range of issues associated with animal agriculture. And when you take animal agriculture out of the equation, it helps solve a lot of these issues. It's the only way to solve a lot of these issues. We can continue to put Band-Aids over it, but at the end of the day, if we don't fix our appetites for animal-based foods and fashion, we're heading down the wrong path and it's just not sustainable.
It can be difficult at times taking the right position, but I think that there are always other people that have those same feelings, and if somebody else steps up first, many other people will follow. And it's a matter of finding that voice and that strength, and I think that's where bravery can come in, to take that position. And I think that you'll be pleasantly surprised to see how many others will take your lead and be inspired by the move that you make.
We're starting to break down that stereotype that you have to be, a sissy to be vegan. You really don't. It's really not being about a sissy. It takes a lot of courage to stand up for what you believe when you're in a culture that says that men especially shouldn't care about animals and it's too sentimental. It actually takes courage to break through that and say, no, I care about animals and I don't care what you think about that, and I'm going to stand up for them. So it's really the courageous men who are vegan.
The question is, what do you stand for? Do you have principles? Are there things that you believe? And are you the kind of person that's going to stand up and say, hey, count me in. These are my principles. This is what I believe, and I'm going to defend them. I'm going to draw that line in the sand. I'm going to say, this is where I stand on it. If you're not that kind of guy, then, you know, hey, maybe veganism isn't for you. But what I'm saying is, if you're the kind of guy that believes in compassion, you believe in mercy, you believe in right versus wrong, then this is the right lifestyle for you. And this is what you need to be doing.
I have traveled from coast to coast in search of vegan food, and I found it everywhere from a truck stop to a Thai restaurant that was out in the middle of nowhere that I think we were the only customers that had been in there in a month. And it was all an adventure, and it was all delicious, and it was all, even when it was a pain in the butt, well worth it.
Park bench somewhere.
Hey.
Hey, sir, are you looking for a vegan nutritionist? Because I'm right over here.